Here we go. All right. These are a little bit different order than they were in yesterday, but it's exactly the same questions. So we will start off with this. Question is M of N of X. Now there's no number, right? So we're not plugging in any numbers. We are simply taking function N and plugging it into M. So M says 4 times something minus 3. We are going to plug this in there for that something. So we're taking function N and plugging it into function M. So our answer will be 4x squared plus 8 minus 3. Just 4x squared plus 5? So again, this problem means whatever N is, plug that into M. All right, second part says, find M of 2 and subtract N of 3. Now this one has a number, so we just plug it in. What's M of 2? What do you get when you put 2 into function M? 5? Right? What do we get when we put 3 into function N? Pay attention, it says N of 3.
11.
So 3 is going into N, and that's 11. And then the problem says, take those two values and subtract them. Negative 6. Olivia?
How did you get 11 from x?
Okay, if we put 3 in here, what's 3 squared? Plus 2. That's how we got it. We're plugging 3 into function n. Now, what is this one saying to do? So we're going to put 1 into N. So what happens if you put 1 into N? We get 3. So this is 3. So now we take that 3 and we plug it into M. And what do we get when we put 3 into M? 9. And that's the answer to the question. So that's what you put down in the answer line. The last number that you get. Okay? And then one more in this section. M of x times n of x. Don't make this hard. What's m of x? They tell you. What's m of x?
4x
minus 3. And what's n of x? And the problem says, multiply them together. That's what that little closed dot means. It means multiply them. So that's a distribute or a FOIL. So 4x cubed minus 3x squared plus 8x minus 6. And that's all there is to it. Don't do anything else. Your job was just to multiply them together. Now, remember, there's only 5 sections on the test. We just did one of them. So there's one section where you're messing around with functions, doing that kind of stuff. Okay? Now, what's next? Find implicit functions. Okay, what does this mean? What am I supposed to do? Oh, shoot. You can't see what I'm doing, can you, Avery? Sorry about that. All right, so what do I have to do if I'm finding the implicit functions? I got to get y by itself. So for this equation, I'll probably, subtract the 2x squared over to the other side. And then what? Square root. And I remember there's going to be two answer blanks, so it'll be the square root of 6 minus 2x squared and negative the square root of 6 minus 2x squared. That is so easy. Let me make a couple of comments here. Does anything change under the radical? No, no. Those two problems, those two answers are exactly the same, except one has a negative in front of the radical. Do I simplify this? Because, oh, I have a square root and I have an x squared. Can I simplify that? No, no, no. When you take the square root of both sides, it stays that way, period. Don't change it. That's it. That's the answer. Right there. Easy. Right? Sean?
So I was having, just kind of struggling on this, like, this concept.
We're just getting y by itself. So we're taking our equation, we're moving this over, and then we're square rooting. So that now we have y by itself.
Yeah, okay.
That's it. That's all there is to it. So I'm not sure what you're starting with. You can come into office hours and we'll talk about it, okay? You can't get it sorted out. Okay. Now we have a section about domain. So what do you have to be thinking about when we talk about domain? What's in your brain? Yep. Denominator cannot equal zero. So I'm just going to go through the problems, and any of them that have a denominator, I'm going to make sure it's not zero. So does this one have a denominator? Nope. This one does, right? So 3x minus 1 cannot be zero. The denominator cannot be zero. So 3x cannot be 1, and x cannot be 1/3. There you go. Denominator cannot be 0. Does this one have a denominator? Nope. This one does. So x minus 3 cannot be 0, which means x cannot be 3. Thing I have to worry about. When I do domain, I definitely have to worry about denominators. What else do I worry about? Radicals. And what do I worry about there? Whatever is under it has to be bigger than or equal to zero. It can't be negative. So x minus 1 is bigger than or equal to 0, so x is bigger than or equal to 1. The denominator, the radicand, the thing under the radical, is bigger than or equal to 0. Every time, that's the rule. I add 1 to both sides, x is bigger than or equal to 1. Does this one have a radical? Does this one have a radical?
No.
This one does. So x plus 2 is greater than or equal to 0, so x is greater than or equal to negative 2. For that last problem, we actually have two different parts to the answer. Why are there two different parts to the answer? Well, because there's a denominator and there's a radical. And those are the two problem areas. Okay? Now, I have nothing written down for this one. What's the domain for this one?
All reals.
And the domain for that one is all reals because it doesn't have a radical or a denominator. Okay? So, domain. Whatever is under the radical has to be bigger than or equal to 0. Whatever is in the denominator cannot be 0. Go through each of your problems, take care of those two things, and that's it. That's going to be your answer. Alrighty. What's next? Now we have the graphing part. Okay. So some of these graphs are easy and some are a little bit trickier. So here's where you got to know your BFFs, because you have to be able to graph that. What shape will it be?
A V.
And it's been moved though, because normally your V would start right here, but not this one. Where has it moved?
Left
2 and
up
1. So I'm going to go ahead and plot that point, left 2 and up 1, and draw my V. Please make sure that you are labeling the important points. So the bottom of that V, the vertex of that V, is an important point. Make sure you label it. Here is the hard one. So remember, you get half credit if you have the shape right. So everybody in the room should know at this point what a sine looks like. So you should be able to do that part. Getting it positioned correctly is a little bit tricky. You have to remember that the original sine oscillates between 1 and negative 1. Okay? So the ceiling on the original is at 1 and the floor is at negative 1. That's the original sign. Now pretend you have a pair of scissors, cut that out and paste it 2 units up. So if you did that, if you brought this up 2 units, wouldn't, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, wouldn't the ceiling now be at 3? And the floor would now be at 1. So now my hills and valleys are oscillating up here like this. Now I know that's a little bit tricky, but like I said, you get half credit if you just get the shape right, and everybody knows the shape. Or should at this point. All right, what's C look like? See, now this is easier. That's a tough one. That's probably the hardest question on the whole test. What about C? C is easier.
Quadratic.
It's quadratic, which means it has what shape?
A parabola.
Some of you say U. It's a parabola. It looks like a U. It's been moved, though. Where has it been moved? So again, you have the right shape, you get half credit. If you got it in the wrong spot, you're gonna lose the other half. You gotta have it in the right shape and the right spot. What's going on with D? That's your cubing function. Which, show me in the air, what's a cubing function look like? Squiggly, right? That's your squiggly. Normally, it squiggles through the origin. Where is this one going to squiggle?
Two to the left.
Two to the left. Very good. So it comes up like this, and then like this. What shape is this one? Come in the air. What shape is that? That's your arc thing going out, right? Not from the origin, though. This one's been moved also. Where is it moved? Left one and down two.
Why did it go to the left again?
Because it's inside the problem, it's the opposite of what you think. Alright, last one is your piecewise function, but you guys are pretty good at these actually, which is awesome. Because this is worth more points, because it has more pieces to it. Sketch this thing. What's the very first thing you do when you look at a problem like this? I put in my squiggly line. Yeah, so right here at negative one is my squiggly line. And all my squiggly line is used for is that's where I put the dots, the open and closed dots, and then that's where I erase from. So once I put the dot on there, I erase one side of the picture, right? So my dot, my squiggly line is where the dots go. Once I get that in there, then I'm just going to start graphing. And I think I'm going to graph this one first. Because that, to me, that's easy. I know what that looks like. What shape is that going to be? A V moved up one. So that is just going to be my normal absolute value V moved up one. And I'll put a circle, an open dot. Yeah. Oh, actually closed dot. I'm doing this one.
Oh.
So I'll put a closed dot there where it crosses the squiggly line. And then I have to pay attention to which way the arrow is going. The arrow is going that way, which means I keep that part of the picture. So I will erase this part of the picture.
Yep.
Now I'm going to wrap this one. And this is not hard, but it's what is that? What is y equals 3x minus 4? What shape is that going to be? That's a line. This is mx plus b. So my intercept is down here at negative 4. That's where I'm going to start. And then I'm going to do a slope of 3. So that means I'm going to go 1 up 3 and over 1 and up 3 and over 1 and so on. So I'm going to get, I always have such a hard time drawing straight lines. That's supposed to be a straight line. This one's a little bit different because I had it down too low. Remember, it's not where it crosses this that I pay attention to. It's where I cross this. So my open dot's going to be way down there. And I'm doing the green. So I'm keeping this part right here and getting rid of all the rest of it. So my actual picture, and I apologize that it's off the screen here, but the official picture is this little piece of E right here, and then this little arrow thing shooting down there. Okay, almost done. You're almost taking the whole test, and I have one more section to go. And this last section is the part about the asymptotes. All right, so let's look at problem first. And you want vertical asymptotes, horizontal asymptotes, and hooks. All right, so tell me anything about that.
No holes.
No holes. How do we know, Savannah?
Nothing can cancel out.
Nothing can cancel. Holes happen when you cancel. Nothing is going to cancel out of that problem. Kids, canceling happens when you do this. Can I do that with this problem?
No.
So there are no holes. All right, Roxy? You gonna say something? Oh, come on now. You know where there's a vertical asymptote? Or horizontal, either one. Well, I think you do know. Here's your horizontal. Where's your horizontal? Y equals 2/3. How do we get horizontal asymptotes? That's when we box in our x's. Right? Vertical asymptotes are like domain. They come from the bottom. Somebody said, actually, it would be positive 4/3. Because if you set that equal to 0,
oh, gotcha.
Don't you get positive 4/3?
Yes.
You find vertical asymptotes the same way you find domain. The denominator can't be 0. Right? That's your vertical asymptote. That's your horizontal, and there aren't any holes. What about problem B? Tell me anything at all about problem B. No, you're not. Tell me how you got it. What's wrong with that?
There should be a 0 x.
Yeah, I can't box in an x squared and a regular x. Those can't be boxed in. I have to have an x squared. And that would be 1/0, which is not nothing. That's right. There's no horizontal asymptote. Vertical is x equals -5. Where do vertical asymptotes come from?
Denominator.
Denominator, denominator, denominator. When you box in, the letters gotta match. an x, I got a 1x squared on the top and no x squareds on the bottom. 1 over 0 does not exist. How about holes? None, because the only way to get a hole is to cancel. Now, I know the top factors. And it doesn't hurt a thing. Go ahead and factor it. But even if I factor it, does anything cancel? No. No holes. To get a hole, you have to cancel. All right, one more problem, and this test will be over. Here we go, the big one. What do you think we should do first? So, tell me how you might factor this.
Pull the 2 out.
Pull the 2 out, okay? That sounds like a good plan.
And then,
wait a second, let me catch up. So, x squared minus 16. Okay, then what?
Can you factor the bottom?
How does the bottom factor? Plus 5 minus 4. How about the top? Well, I already took a 2 out, but isn't there some other factoring I can do on the top?
X plus 4,
x minus 4. Now, are your little hearts just going pitter patter? Because what do you notice? You can cancel. So the problem is going to become 2x plus 4 over x plus 5. Now, because we canceled, we are going to have a hole. The x, the hole is a point, has an x and a y. The x is going to come from what canceled. So the x is going to be 4. Where's the y going to come from? Plugging it back in, and you plug it right back in here. This is our new and reduced problem. So we're going to plug in 4. So 2 times 4 plus 4 over 4 plus 5. I'm putting in 4 for the x's. So 2 times 8 over 9, you get 16 ninths. If you didn't, we need to fix that. I think that's right. But I might have made a mistake.
I have a question. Why would it be negative 4?
Because, where's the accent going to be?
Oh, gotcha.
Negative 5?
Yep.
Yeah, same concept.
Gotcha.
So it's the opposite.
Right.
When you're dealing with the parentheses, it's always the opposite.
I thought you were trying to take more.
Alright, everybody get that problem as a whole, the other ones didn't. Because here we can cancel and we couldn't before. Alright, what about asymptotes? Look right here in the box. Tell me about asymptotes.
Is it 2? Because if you box it in, it's 2 over 1.
If you box it in, y equals 2 is your horizontal asymptote. Kids, you could have done that from the beginning, right? Because you would box in the highest power, so it would be x squared. But notice, if you do x squared, isn't it still y equals 2?
Will that be the same case for all problems?
All horizontals.
Okay, yeah.
Not verticals, because here you have 2, but you really only have 1. So your vertical asymptote is at x equals negative 5. Next time we are together, we'll do the last.